Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us for the U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame induction ceremony honoring our nation's space heroes. Please rise for the presentation of colors, followed by the national anthem performed by Susie Cunningham of Kennedy Space Center's Advanced Planning Office.
Twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome today's Master of Ceremonies, former CNN correspondent and award-winning journalist, Mr. John Zarella.
Thank you, folks. What a great-looking group of astronauts down there, huh? Thank you. I didn't mean you, Kurt Brown. I was talking about the women, the lady astronauts, not you guys. Thank you, Titusville Boy Scout Troop 481 and Susie. That was terrific, absolutely wonderful. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I am honored to be here once again as your Master of Ceremonies for the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame induction, especially on the 25th anniversary. This is the second year that the incredible Space Shuttle Atlantis has hosted this prestigious event. All four of our inductees are Space Shuttle astronauts, and what a great tribute it is to be inducted into the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame right under one of their own. And now, it is my privilege to introduce to all of you the attending members of the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame. He served as lunar module pilot for 11 days aboard Apollo 7, the first manned Apollo mission and the first to provide a live television transmission of onboard crew activities. He later served as NASA's chief of the Skylab branch of the Flight Crew Directorate, Walt Cunningham. Command module pilot for Apollo 15 and a 9-year NASA veteran, he logged a 38-minute spacewalk outside the Endeavour command module to retrieve film from the panoramic and mapping cameras. He logged 295 hours and 11 minutes in space. Al Warden.
Yeah.
He served as pilot for Skylab, during which he worked in orbit for 59 days and spent 11 hours on two spacewalks outside the space station. Later, he commanded the third orbital test flight of Space Shuttle Columbia STS-3, Jack Lausma. This astronaut piloted Columbia in 1981 on STS-1, the very first space shuttle mission. He went on to command three more missions, including STS-7, which conducted the first deployment and retrieval exercise with the Shuttle Pallet satellite. He later served as director of NASA's Kennedy Space Center. Bob Crippen. During his 19 years with the astronaut program, he logged more than 386 hours in space and flew on three shuttle missions. He served as pilot during the maiden voyage of Shuttle Challenger aboard STS-6, as commander of STS-51D, and as commander of STS-51J, the first flight of Space Shuttle Atlantis. Carol Bo Bobko. A three-space flight veteran, he was on the first crew to fly an orbiter in close proximity to a free-flying satellite on STS-7. He then commanded STS-51A and later STS-26, which marked the space shuttle's return to flight following the Challenger tragedy. Rick Houck. A veteran of four space shuttle missions, he piloted STS-8, the first mission with a night launch and landing. He spent 261 hours in space during STS-32, the longest shuttle mission to date. And I guess that means forever, right? To date? No? Till that date. And later commanded STS-49, the maiden flight of Space Shuttle Endeavour. Dan Brandenstein. Dan? Logging more than 500 hours in space, he piloted STS-9 and later commanded STS-61B and STS-28. He also played a key role in returning shuttle to flight following the Challenger accident, leading the Space Shuttle Orbiter Return to Flight team. Brewster Shaw. This astronaut, a veteran of five space shuttle flights, served as pilot for STS-41B, which culminated in the first landing on Kennedy Space Center's runway. He then commanded STS-61C, STS-27, STS-47, and STS-71, the first space shuttle mission to dock with the Russian space station Mir. Hoot Gibson. He will be forever remembered by an iconic photo taken of him flying freely without a tether over the Earth on mission STS-41B. During the flight, he tested the manned maneuvering unit, a jet-powered backpack that allowed him to float away from the shuttle. 6 years later, he returned to space aboard Discovery to deploy the Hubble Space Telescope. Bruce McCandless. A veteran of three space flights, he logged more than 463 hours in space. He served as pilot of STS-41D, commander of STS-29 and STS-39. He also served as director of Johnson's Space Center in Houston, Texas. Michael Coates. He logged over 770 hours in space over the course of five space shuttle missions, including STS-41D, the maiden flight of Discovery. During his third flight, STS-31, he helped deploy the Hubble Space Telescope and assisted in the servicing on his next mission. Steve Hawley. He served as pilot of STS-51C and commander of STS-31, which deployed the Hubble Space Telescope, and STS-46, which conducted the first tethered satellite system test flight. From 1997 to 2000, he was deputy director of NASA's Kennedy Space Center. Lauren Shriver. A veteran of five space shuttle missions, he became the first astronaut to log 1,000 hours on the space shuttle and made NASA's first shuttle contingency spacewalk. He's logged 21.5 million miles in space. Jeff Hoffman. A four-time space shuttle veteran, he has logged over 646 hours in space. He distinguished himself as both commander of the first Hubble Space Telescope repair mission and as pilot of Discovery for the shuttle program's return to flight following the Challenger accident. Dick Covey. She logged more than 1,200 hours, 53 days in space. She served as mission specialist for STS-61A and STS-32, and payload commander on STS-50 and STS-89. In 1995, she made space history aboard Atlantis on STS-71 by docking with the Russian space station Mir. Bonnie Dunbar. He has logged 1,393 hours in space, including 58 hours, 18 minutes during nine spacewalks. He is the recipient of 15 NASA medals and was awarded the American Astronautical Society's Victor A. Prather Award for his numerous spacewalking achievements. Jerry Ross. A veteran of four space shuttle flights, he piloted STS-61C and STS-31, which deployed the Hubble Space Telescope, then served as commander for STS-45 and STS-60, logging more than 680 hours in orbit. Today, he serves as NASA's Administrator Charles Bolden. During his 24 years in the astronaut program, this astronaut logged more than 66 days in space on seven space shuttle missions. Too many to read all the numbers out. A record he shares with fellow astronaut Jerry Ross, a 2012 inductee. He currently serves as CEO of the Ad Astra Rocket Company, Franklin Chang Diaz. He has logged 161 days in space on five missions. He served as pilot of STS-29 and STS-33, and commander of STS-43 and STS-58. This astronaut became the third American to live aboard the Russian space station Mir, setting an American record of 128 days in orbit. John Blaha. She has logged over 975 hours in space, including more than 21 hours of extravehicular activity. She flew four space shuttle missions, including STS-49, the maiden flight of the space shuttle Endeavour. Kathy Thornton. He is a veteran of four space flights and has logged 38 days in space. He piloted STS-41. STS-53, served as commander of STS-65 and STS-88. During STS-65, he and his crew set a record for the longest space shuttle mission at that time. He is currently the center director right here at NASA's Kennedy Space Center, Bob Cabana. Hope that was short enough, Bob. He's a veteran of three space flights and has logged more than 146 days in space. As commander of STS-51, he conducted the first shuttle night landing at KSC. On his final mission during Expedition 3, he commanded the International Space Station for 117 days. Frank Culbertson. He is a veteran of six space flights, during which he logged more than 1,380 hours, 57 days in space. He served as pilot for STS-47, STS-66, and STS-77. Served as commander aboard STS-85, STS-95, and STS-103. Did I get them all right, Kurt? Kurt Brown. She's a veteran of four space flights, logging more than 870 hours, around 35 days in space. She first made history in 1995 when she took the controls of Discovery on STS-63 and became the first woman space shuttle pilot. She again made history as commander of Columbia on STS-93. In 2005, she commanded the STS-114 to test and evaluate new procedures for flight safety, shuttle inspection, and repair techniques. Eileen Collins. He is a veteran of three space shuttle missions, logging more than 455 hours in space. He served as pilot on STS-51B Skylab 3 and was the spacecraft commander on STS-33 and STS-44. Fred Gregory. Ladies and gentlemen, our Hall of Fame astronauts. Was it this hot in the spacesuits? He's nodding. You had air conditioning in them, right? I thought so. Before we continue, I would like to mark the passing of two astronauts since our last Astronaut Hall of Fame induction ceremony. Hall of Fame Space Shuttle astronaut Hank Hartsfield Jr. and Space Shuttle astronaut Steve Nagel. These legends made remarkable contributions to the exploration of space, and their legacy lives on through their respective educational endeavors. Let's take a moment to remember these men. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage our Chief Operating Officer of the Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex, Mr. Theron Protzi. Theron.
Good afternoon, and thank you to all for attending today's event. On behalf of the 60,000 Delaware North World Associates worldwide, including those of us at the Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex, we welcome you to today's induction ceremony celebrating the 14th class of Space Shuttle astronauts entering the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame. The Visitor Complex is honored to host today's ceremony celebrating the achievements of four NASA astronauts: John Grunsfeld, Steve Lindsey, Kent Rominger, and Rhea Seddon, as they are welcomed into an elite group of space exploration heroes. This year also marks the 25th anniversary of the Astronaut Hall of Fame. Last year was the first time we held the induction under Space Shuttle Atlantis, displayed like no other space shuttle in the world. While Atlantis will always be one of our most esteemed exhibits, we are in the midst of a groundbreaking of our newest attraction that is all about the men and women who are being celebrated today. Yesterday, we broke ground on NASA's Heroes and Legends featuring the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame. It's scheduled to open in 2016. The exhibit will not only bring the life of the enthralling stories of Americans' pioneering astronauts, but will also invite guests to vicariously experience the thrills and dangers of America's earliest missions through high-tech elements and special effects, including simulated holograms and augmented reality. The highlight of Heroes and Legend is an omnidirectional theater, which will include 3D and special effects designed to make the guests feel as though they are floating in the vastness of space. Stunning images will envelop from every direction as legendary astronauts, including Alan Shepard, John Glenn, Jim Lovell, and Neil Armstrong, invite them to join the epic journeys into the vast unknown. The new Astronaut Hall of Fame will occupy the current early space exploration just right inside the mission gates, will serve as a culminating element of attraction, allowing guests to interact virtually with nearly 100 astronaut heroes. This exhibit is meant to honor our space pioneers, many of whom are with us today, and also inspire young minds. I'd like to share with you briefly a few of the projects we have just recently undertaken. Earlier this year, we added a 3D film, Journey to Space, to the lineup of our IMAX theater. This incredible film showcases NASA's bold plans for the future, including landing astronauts on Mars and capturing asteroids, while recognizing the space shuttle program and its many accomplishments. We are also celebrating the grand reopening of the renovated Orbit Cafe with a new look, a new menu, and an improved flow to expedite guest service while utilizing NASA's technology of hydroponics to grow greens to put in your meals. Finally, this week, we open the new Journey to Mars attraction, a redesigned and updated guest experience previously known as Explorer Space, Explorers Wanted. Here, guests are invited to see how one day, very soon, humans will explore the red planet. At Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex, we are focused on the educational aspect of spaceflight and the science, technology, engineering, and math known as STEM activities needed to become an astronaut or an aerospace professional. Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex strives to inspire minds through a memorable space experience. I'd like to recognize today the contributions by the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation, the Board of Directors, Executive Director Tammy Knowles, and her team of staff and volunteers. Since 2001, when the first space shuttle class was inducted, we have been honored to work with ASF. On behalf of Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex, I'd like to take a moment to thank you for years of dedication, service, and incredible work. Now, since I've learned that Mr. Cabana does not like long introductions, I'd like to welcome Kennedy Space Center Center Director, Mr. Robert Cabana.
Awesome, somebody that finally takes direction. Hey, it's my sincere pleasure to welcome you all here to the 2015 Astronaut Hall of Fame induction. And man, John, Ray, where is everybody sitting? I can't see them. I guess they're gonna march in later, but you know, John, Ray, Steve, and Kent, you know, you have my sincere congratulations, and it's very well deserved. And it's so great to see everybody's families here, and what an awesome homecoming. It's just so much fun to see all the folks when they come back to KSC. We've been really busy here at the Kennedy Space Center the last few years. I don't know if you've noticed, but we have transformed ourselves into a multi-user spaceport. And we have an awesome future, and I really believe that we are making it happen, and it's going to be superb. You know, just as during the Apollo timeframe, 50 years ago, we turned KSC into a moonport, we are now putting the architecture in space to make KSC a Marsport. We're going to be launching to Mars from pad 39B, and that is just pretty darn awesome. And at the same time, we are enabling commercial operations to low Earth orbit, and I think that's pretty special. We have a great story to share, and I hope that you get a chance to go see that new IMAX film, 3D IMAX film, Journey to Mars. It's outstanding. The new exhibit, Journey to Mars, Journey to Space is a 3D IMAX film. As exciting as our past is when you read about it here and see it, you know, I think our future is even more exciting. There are great things happening. So I want to thank you all for coming today. I hope that you enjoy your day here. And again, my sincere congratulations to our four new inductees. It is absolutely super. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Cabana. And now, with another very short introduction, please welcome to the podium Hall of Fame astronaut and NASA Administrator Charlie Bolden.
Thank you. Thanks very much, John, and thanks to everyone for coming out this afternoon and joining us for the festivities. This, for me, always tends to be an emotional and a moving weekend, even when, you know, after my own induction. It's a great time to get together, as others have said, great reunion, but today it's a special opportunity for us to welcome four new members and four new families, as a matter of fact. The men and women we recognize today help us realize that not only is NASA one big family, it's also a family that belongs to the American people, to you and the audience. We all take pride in its accomplishments, we share in its tragedies, and we root for it as it faces new and greater challenges. To John Grunsfeld, to Steve Lindsey, Kent Rominger, Rhea Seddon, I hope that's not one of them falling. No, it's not. It's the kid up there in the mousetrap. I think they always turn them loose when I come to the podium. I think that happened last year. You know, they want to see if I can get distracted and get back to my script. They're neat. I offer my deepest congratulations to the four new inductees today. You know, John, as Bob said, you have our deep, John, Steve, Kent, and Ray, you have our deepest respect for all that you have achieved in space, for the examples that you set for others, and most importantly, for the inspiration that you have given future generations to take us on a journey to Mars. We have here at this weekend's celebrations astronauts representing the full spectrum of NASA's history to date. Each time we have closed one chapter, there's always been another challenge to pursue. Whether that was moving from the first humans to orbit Earth and walk in space, and I'd like to give a special shout out on this 50th anniversary of the first spacewalk to Ed White, who participated in the first American spacewalk, to landing on the moon or making the first full flight of the space shuttle, and also the same flight on which it flew with humans for the very first time. For those of you who didn't understand what I just said, the significance of shuttle was that unlike other vehicles where we flew a test flight, an unmanned, unpersoned test flight, the guys sitting down here on the front row that everybody ranted and raved about, Bob Crippen and John Young, actually took shuttle to orbit with no test flights prior to that. That was a big deal for those of you who don't remember back then. You know, whether it's going on to constructing the marvel that we today call the International Space Station, or doggedly pursuing the technologies that will take us to an asteroid and to Mars, the story of NASA has been and continues to be of new beginnings. It has always been one of success built on the strong foundation of what has come before. So today, as we recognize and celebrate these astronauts, the newest class of astronaut candidates from our most recent class of 2013 is back in Houston preparing for its future space missions. Our industry partners have demonstrated that our faith and investment in them was sound, and they have followed through with one success after another. We now have regular commercial cargo missions to the station, and commercial crew is not far behind with SpaceX and Boeing rapidly moving us to a time when astronauts will once again launch from the United States, from right here on the Space Coast, to missions in low Earth orbit that are laying the groundwork for missions to deep space. Not far from where we are today, engineers are combing through the Orion crew module that flew to space last December 5th to uncover the treasure trove of data it returned to us about its heat shield and other systems. Having just successfully completed a full run test on our second RS-25 engine at the Stennis Space Center this past Thursday, we're continuing to test the propulsion systems of the Space Launch System rocket that will propel astronauts aboard Orion to newer and more distant destinations. We're also testing technologies like enhanced solar electric propulsion and the low-density supersonic decelerator that will help us land on other planets. The next robotic mission to Mars, InSight, takes off next year as a precursor to humans visiting the red planet. And spacecraft like Juno, which is traveling to Jupiter, and New Horizons, which is in a few short weeks making its closest flyby of Pluto, are firing the imaginations of people around the globe about where else we could go and what else we could do. That kind of inspiration is probably one of the most precious gifts that our new inductees of this Hall of Fame have given us. Whether that was John Grunsfeld proving time and time again that Hubble Space Telescope could be rejuvenated and made even better each time, or Steve Lindsey helping our space shuttle fleet return to flight by commanding the second return to flight mission after STS-107 following the loss of Columbia. Or Kent Rominger commanding the first space shuttle to dock to the station with 4 tons of logistics and supplies to prepare for the arrival of the first crew to live on station, a journey that has continued now uninterrupted for almost 15 years. Or Rhea Seddon, helping us to learn more about human health in space as she blazed the trail for other women to follow. They all have lent us their expertise and their passions. They have had careers of distinction from which we have all benefited. Truly, these four are heroes and legends, as we're calling the new exhibit on which we broke ground yesterday. They stand on the shoulders of those who came before, and others will stand on theirs as we continue to reach higher. We're on a journey to Mars right now, The students I speak with around the world are excited about it. The space generation of today is ready to do its part to achieve its own milestones in space. And our four astronaut inductees today have given them the hand up they need to become the future inductees into this wonderful place. If there is one thing of which I'm sure, it's that NASA's journey has just begun, and there will be room for many more exceptional American stories to be told in this Hall of Fame. My congratulations again to the four honorees, John, Steve, Kent, and Ray. Now, it's time for us to hear their stories.
Thank you, Mr. Bolden. You know, it's got to be a conspiracy, Charlie. Those same kids were up there last year. Same ones. And now, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Hall of Fame astronaut and Astronaut Scholarship Foundation Chairman Dan Brandenstein. Dan?
Well, good afternoon and welcome to everyone. Thanks for coming to this really great event. As chairman of the Astronaut Foundation, let me first say how happy we are that you're all here and to join in welcoming John and Steve and Kent and Ray to the 14th class of the U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame. And it's our pleasure to be part of that great occasion. As you may have heard, this is an exciting year for the Hall of Fame because it's the 25th anniversary. The Hall of Fame was originally started by the original seven astronauts as a place where space explorers can be honored. The overall goal of the Hall of Fame was to inspire and encourage students to pursue scientific study and develop technology after they graduate, leading to keep U.S. a leader in technology. They also were instrumental in starting the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation, which awards merit-based scholarships to the best and brightest students in the field of science, engineering, technology, and math. The prestigious Astronaut Scholarship is known nationwide as being among the highest scholarships awarded to undergraduate STEM students. Since its inception, the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation has awarded over $4 million in scholarships to over 350 of the nation's top scholars. This morning, 27 of them were out presenting some of their research, and we're fortunate to have them with us here today. So if the astronaut scholars would stand up, we'd certainly like to recognize the great job they're doing. Of course, the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation can't do it alone. We receive support from all of the astronauts, from our friends at NASA, Charlie Bolden, Bob Cabana, as well as Theron Protzi at the Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex. The help and support they provide is invaluable, and their involvement is truly appreciated. Thank you very much, you guys. And John, now let's get on with the real business here and get those guys inducted. And girl.
You're right, Dan. Time to move the show along, isn't it? And the time has arrived. The induction of the 14th class of Space Shuttle astronauts into the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame. Our first inductee is John Grunsfeld.
To view the universe.
Well, this is the first time that astronomers have really been able to get a look at these objects with the kind of quality that we get from the big mountaintop observatory. So this is an extremely exciting time for astronomers all over the world.
And liftoff of the Space Shuttle Atlantis on a 10-day mission to dock with Russia's orbiting outpost.
space station there.
We have booster ignition and liftoff of the Space Shuttle Discovery.
I feel especially privileged, as do all the crew members on board, to have had the chance to work on the world's greatest telescope.
And liftoff of Space Shuttle Columbia.
See the cutoff.
Liftoff.
Up here on Columbia on STS 109, we've just finished 5 days of spacewalking.
Liftoff of Space Shuttle Flights.
We got the Hubble and gave Hubble a hug.
John Grunsfeld, Ph.D., was selected as a NASA astronaut in March 1992. A five-flight veteran, he has logged more than 58 days in space, including 58 hours and 30 minutes of extravehicular activity over the course of eight spacewalks. Grunsfeld's first flight was STS-67 aboard Endeavour as a mission specialist. Launched on March 2, 1995, this record-setting 16-day mission was the second flight of the Astro Observatory, a unique complement of three ultraviolet telescopes. Grunsfeld served as flight engineer on his second flight, STS-81, Atlantis. This mission launched January 12th, was the fifth flight to dock with the Russian space station Mir, and the second to exchange U.S. astronauts. Grunsfeld returned to space on the third Hubble Space Telescope servicing mission aboard Discovery, STS-103, in 1999 as a mission specialist. In 2002, payload commander Grunsfeld flew on STS-109 Columbia, the fourth Hubble servicing mission, and the fifth aboard STS-125 Atlantis in 2009. Grunsfeld retired from NASA in December of 2009 to become the deputy director of the Space Telescope Science Institute and a professor of physics and astronomy at Johns Hopkins University. He later rejoined NASA in 2012 and is currently the agency associate administrator of the Science Mission Directorate at NASA headquarters in Washington, D.C. Ladies and gentlemen, astronaut John Grunsfeld. To present John Grunsfeld for induction into the U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame, please welcome Hall of Fame astronaut Steve Hawley.
Thank you, John. Well, I'm truly honored to be able to present John for induction in the Astronaut Hall of Fame, and I want to first start by saying thanks to Carol and Marcia and lots of my secret sources, many of whom I've sworn to protect. They were kind enough, though, to share with me stories that I can share with you all about John. They also shared with me stories they made me promise never to share. But here we go. John was born and grew up in the Chicago area, and it sounded to me like he got his sense of curiosity and willingness to tackle anything from his mother, whom I'm told was always learning and always interested in many things. Now in Chicago, there's a famous planetarium called the Adler. I actually think I remember visiting the Adler when I was really young. We lived in Chicago for a time. Adler is just celebrating its 85th anniversary, and it's the first planetarium of its kind ever built in the Western Hemisphere. What I didn't know was that John's grandfather was an architect, and John's grandfather designed the Adler Planetarium. John spent a lot of time there when he was young, and that no doubt inspired his interest in space and astronomy. In fact, John developed a fascination for the moon. And when John was about four or five, perhaps on a visit to Adler, his mom asked John and his sister what they wanted to do when they grew up. And John's answer was, "I want to go to the moon." Not wanting to inhibit her children's dreams, his mother would never say something like, well, you can't do that. John was like a lot of us when he was young. He had in mind the ideal career. When he was 6 or 7, he decided he wanted to be an astronaut or drive an 18-wheeler. John was interested in science from an early age and wanted to go to space to do science, astronomy specifically. He was interested in flying at an early age as well. When he was 9 or thereabouts, he launched himself off the kitchen counter. As you've heard, any landing you can walk away from is a good landing. And John survived that with only a few stitches, I'm told. But this was perhaps one of the first manifestations of John's sense of adventure and his approach to risk-taking, which I would paraphrase as saying, there are some objectives that are so worthwhile that it's worth the risk. One of John's childhood friends told me about the time that he and John made gunpowder using the formula from the old Star Trek original series episode, The Arena, where Captain Kirk takes on the Gorn. I asked John's friend, did it work? And he told me, well, if your eyebrows can substitute for an alien, then yes. Enthusiastic construction of model rockets was also part of John's growing up, and I understand that that effort subsequently devolved into just sticking fuses into rocket motors and seeing where they would go when they were ignited. And I'm also told that when John was in high school, he demasted the family sailboat after attempting to take it out in Lake Michigan in 50-knot winds. Evidently, John was truly inspired by the fact that his mother never told him, you can't do this. John went on to college at MIT, where he got a BS in physics. For a time, he worked for Jeff Hoffman. And it may have been there that John realized that astronomers could become astronauts, because while John was at MIT, Jeff got selected in the first class of shuttle astronauts in 1978. John was involved in astronomy from space before he was selected by NASA. At MIT, he helped to analyze data obtained from a balloon-borne detector that was observing X-rays coming from this thing we called SIGX-1. That's astronomer speak for the first X-ray source ever discovered in the constellation Cygnus. But the reason it was important was because it was the very best candidate we had for something that we thought might be a black hole. Interestingly, black holes is one of the discoveries that we can attribute to Hubble, so now we know they truly exist. After graduating from MIT, John went back to Chicago, went to the University of Chicago, got a master's and a PhD in physics. And when he was in graduate school at Chicago, he worked on data obtained by an instrument flown on Space Lab 2 in 1985, investigating the composition of the various highest energy cosmic rays. After obtaining his PhD, John went to Caltech, where he worked with data from the Gamma Ray Observatory, analyzing one of the few known at that time binary pulsars. John and I are both proud members of the Hubble Huggers Club, although I would argue that John came late to Hubble hugging because of the problem we had with HST after the initial launch. I think I heard John say this the other day, that he was concerned that money might be diverted from the Gamma Ray Observatory to work on Hubble. John applied to be an astronaut while he was at Caltech and got selected for an interview, and I was on the selection board that year. I remember one of the questions that we would typically ask candidates was something like, you know, what are your long-term career plans, or what do you see yourself doing in 10 or 20 years? John's answer was he wanted to work at NASA headquarters. So we didn't pick him. During his visit, which was in 1989, one of the senior scientists who was in the astronaut office told John that it would be a waste of time for a talented space scientist to become a NASA mission specialist. And I can relate to that, because when I applied, a very famous astronomer told me, why would I throw away a promising career in astronomy to become an astronaut? But of course, John isn't likely to accept somebody telling him he can't do something, and so he reapplied in 1992. The other thing I remember from his interview was we were talking about his thesis, and it may have, I don't know who asked the question, but the question was something of the form like, well, you know, what would you say to somebody about why would you spend money studying, you know, gamma rays, high energy cosmic rays? And John's answer was, it's basic research. You don't need to justify basic research. How do you feel about that now? We did select John in the class of 1992, and you saw in the video his spaceflight career, and John described the missions he flew on. Certainly, John Grunsfeld is best known for his work on three HST missions and EVAs totaling almost 60 hours. Perhaps as an example of John's legendary attention to detail, one of his EVA crewmates told me the story. I won't tell you which mission it is, so I don't want to indict anybody. But, you know, if you're out there in the EVA, I haven't done an EVA, but I've watched EVAs, and if you're out there doing an EVA and you're starting to wrap your tether around the solar array, that's not cool. And you don't want your buddy saying on open air to ground, hey, get your tether away from the solar arrays. So John and his friend developed a code word. So if it looked like something needed attention, one or the other would say, Madagascar. And so John's working on or near HST, and his buddy sees the tether not doing exactly what it's supposed to do and says, hey, John, Madagascar. And John looks up at the Earth and says, no, that's South America. And his buddy goes, no, John, Madagascar. And he goes, no, I'm sure that's South America. So maybe that's too much attention to detail. There's a consensus, without a doubt, John is gifted at taking things apart and putting them back together, which along with his commitment to accomplishing what he sets out to do has served HST very well. I want to just share with you some of my recollections of the last servicing mission after Mike Griffin authorized one more mission to HST. One of the problems that I recall we faced was there was a lot to do, and we only had five EVAs in one last mission to get it done. And in particular, one of the things we wanted to do was repair the advanced cameras for surveys. The ACS was the workhorse instrument ever since we launched it in 2002, and it had a failure. And if I remember right, repairing the ACS was like the last priority, and if we didn't get it everything, if we couldn't get everything else done, then ACS might not get repaired. And John was not going to let that happen. We were going to get ACS repaired. And to make it even more complex, of course, ACS wasn't designed to be repaired. And John had something like 150,000 non-captive screws that he had to deal with and a variety of other challenges. But he just saw that, again, as, you know, that's just another challenge. Let's go do it. And ACS got repaired, and all of the tasks got repaired. And after SM4 was done, HST was in better shape than it was when we launched it in 1990. I learned something that I will share with you now that I've only known for like an hour. I talked to Matt Mountain, who was the director of the Institute when John flew 125. And John confirms this, that when John retired from NASA, he went to work as a deputy at the Institute. And Matt said that John applied for the job while he was actually on orbit. And that he threatened to hold the telescope hostage. And the reason that struck me as interesting was because I had a similar thought in STS-31. I was thinking, okay, I got the telescope here. What if I tell them I'm not going to release it unless you give me telescope time? And then I thought, well, they might then say, we're not going to send you deorbit targets unless you release the telescope. John very much enjoys the outdoors, hiking, mountain climbing, music. He's an avid pilot. John flew his own airplane, I think, to your second interview. One of my sources, Marcia, told me there was a time when they got to see John right before launch, and it was around Christmas, so it must have been Mission 3A. And I think one of Marcia's kids asked John, are you going to see Santa Claus? And I think everybody feared the analytical scientist response, the kind I would give, where you would look at the available evidence bearing on the issue of the true existence of Santa Claus. And John said, sure we are. It's common knowledge that John loved flying in space, but as much John enjoys time with his family. Carol is here, Sarah and Mace are here, as are Carol's parents. Sarah just completed her freshman year at MIT. Mace just graduated yesterday morning, so this has been a hectic weekend for John and Carol, and he's about to go off to Berkeley. And I know that John is proud of what his kids are doing and what they've accomplished, perhaps more than what he is proud of accomplishing himself. And beyond being an inspiration to his family, John has inspired many other young men and women by sharing the excitement he has known from doing science and enabling science through his work with HST at the Institute and now at NASA headquarters in the science office. Let me conclude by thanking John for organizing a 25th anniversary Hubble event last month. I enjoy sharing Hubble results with my students, and I had sort of a eureka moment when I realized that all of them are younger than 25. So as far as they know, Hubble's always been there. So I told them that Hubble began with a vision almost 70 years ago in a paper by a famous astronomer. And people advocated for that vision. In 1973, NASA did a phase A study. In 1977, Hubble was a new start. 13 years of development and testing later, we put it in orbit in 1990. 19 years later, five shuttle missions, we left it, as John left it, in great shape, where it has been revolutionizing our understanding of the universe. All of that took a long time and a lot of people. The astronauts were just a small part that happened at the end, an important part, we think. And I'd like to acknowledge seven of our buddies sitting in the first three rows that were part of those missions. And if you count John and me in the mix, we have people here, at least one person from every shuttle crew that flew with Hubble. So great things don't just happen. It takes vision, it takes hard work, it takes overcoming obstacles, it takes technical expertise, it takes teamwork, and it takes individuals like John Grunsfeld. John's skill helped make HST what it is today and has helped fundamentally change our understanding of the universe. And it promises to do so for years to come. So John, you didn't make it to the moon. You didn't make it to headquarters. And you made it to this time and place. Welcome to the Hall of Fame.
Thank you very much, Steve. Most of those stories are true. I think I was a little bit younger when I launched myself off of the kitchen counter. I think I was about 5 years old. It was about the time I could climb. And I do love flying. I love flying in space. And those who know me know that, you know, I'd love to live in space almost more than I love planet Earth. But I really want to thank the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation, the Hall of Fame. This is a tremendous honor. I'm humbled. You know, the great achievements of the Mercury astronauts, Gemini, I used to have a Gemini lunchbox when I was a kid, you know, Apollo, Skylab, the shuttle program. You know, we learned so many things, and often we credit Project Apollo for teaching us how to do systems engineering, and that's the great achievement. That's definitely not the case. I mean, it is true that we learned systems engineering, we'd learned systems engineering a lot of things. But what we learned how to do is to put together wonderful, great teams of people to achieve great things. And that's the true amazing thing that is hanging above us, is in this room, that certainly the Hubble Space Telescope team is emblematic of, is that we've been able to solve these high-performance challenges with teams of people, with vision, with drive, with enthusiasm. And I feel privileged to have been a member of some of those teams. The Hubble Space Telescope in particular, as Steve Hawley said, has been transformational for me. And it's in part because of the great scientific promise, but also because of the great people, because it helps us answer deep fundamental questions back to basic research. It's helped tell us where we've come from, how we got here, where we're going, and it's opened up a field that someday may tell us whether we're alone in the universe. And that's not unique to Hubble. Our Apollo astronauts who brought back samples of the moon allowed us to help us learn about where the moon came from, but also where the Earth came from. As Administrator Bolden said on July 14th, for the very first time, a spacecraft will fly by the dwarf planet Pluto, and we'll get our first look at a new category of objects in our solar system that represent the origins of our solar system. The team of people that it takes to do a space mission or to develop a new rocket, you know, are tens of thousands of people across the country, in fact, around the world. And it's not just us who are lucky enough to fly in the pointy end of the vehicles, but all kinds of different talents, and many of them are represented in this room. I want to take just a moment and thank my home team, my wife Carol, my daughter Sarah, my son Mace, my sister Marcia, you know, all of my family, and in particular my mom. And as I recall, she was happy when I decided I wanted to be an astronaut at age 6, because she thought it would help my interest in science and math, and she said there's no chance I'd ever actually become an astronaut, so she didn't have to worry. I was recently asked at a public talk what's the greatest challenge facing us in space exploration. And there are so many challenges, and we have so many exciting things ahead of us, and it took me a while to come up with an answer, actually, and it's something that I should have thought about before. And after, you know, a few moments thinking about it, I said STEM education. And it's not just the biggest challenge we face for space exploration. I think that's the biggest challenge we face in its entirety. And that's why I'm especially privileged to have been inducted today and to now be part of the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation. And the folks that gave talks this morning give me great optimism that we are doing the right things and we are inspiring people with our space program, with our engineering programs, with our basic science research. Our journey to Mars, we are on Mars today. Curiosity is our vicarious explorer driving around Mars. We're learning great things. Charlie talked about the InSight mission that's going to launch in 2016. We're partners with the Europeans on two missions to Mars, and we're planning our next steps on Mars, leading hopefully soon to humans around Mars and then to the surface. As Bob Cabana says, it's all going to start here, and I think that's all very exciting. Our mission is to innovate, explore, discover, and inspire. And I can say, even though I'm from headquarters and I'm here to help you, that truly is what we're doing in answering these fundamental science questions with spacecraft, examining the whole solar system, the sun, lots of interest in planet Earth, our home planet, even though many of us have spent our lives trying to get off the planet, and Hubble and other observatories looking out into the universe. It's pretty incredible that we have, you know, a third of our nation that has grown up in a world that has known a Hubble Space Telescope and many of our developments there, the Hubble generation. But looking towards the future, all the great things that we have to look forward to, the James Webb Space Telescope, crews flying on commercial vehicles, crews living on the space station, and on to Mars, hopefully in the near future. So I want to thank the foundation again, my crewmates, Kent Rominger, who is one of my classmates, 14th group of astronauts, now 14th group of inductees. Thank you all very much.
Congratulations, John. Steve, I'm glad you cleared that up about Madagascar, because I remember when I was covering in that spacewalk for CNN, and my producer and I were saying, what the heck are they worried about where they're flying over? Don't they have a job to do out there? So I'm glad it's cleared up now. Our next inductee is Steve Lindsey.
And liftoff of Space Shuttle Columbia.
Roll program. Roger, roll, Columbia.
And Columbia Houston, you have a go for sprint release.
Liftoff of Discovery with a crew of 6 astronaut heroes and 1 American legend.
Houston, Discovery, got a good grapple with Spartan.
Copy that. Great job, Steve.
Welcome aboard, Steve.
Good morning, Jim. Thanks.
Okay, we're going to do a quick ribbon cutting.
Discovery is ready. The weather is beautiful. America is ready to return the space shuttle to flight. So good luck and Godspeed, Discovery.
For all the folks in the Florida East Coast, we hope to very soon get you an up-close and personal look at the rocket's red glare.
Colonel Lindsey, it must be a great honor to be the last commander of Discovery. It's traveled more distance in space and spent more time in orbit than any of its peers in the shuttle fleet. So it's appropriate that it's performing this critical and iconic mission.
Thank you, sir. It's a real privilege for us to get to fly Discovery on her final mission.
Sonic booms now heard at the Kennedy Space Center announcing Discovery's arrival. And nose gear touchdown in the end of a historic journey.
And Houston Discovery for the final time. We'll stop.
U.S. Air Force Colonel Steve Lindsey was selected as a NASA astronaut in March of 1995. A veteran of five space shuttle flights, Lindsey has logged more than 1,510 hours in space. Lindsey first flew in space in 1997 as pilot of STS-87 Columbia, the fourth U.S. microgravity payload flight. During one of the spacewalks on this mission, Lindsey piloted the first flight of the ARC camera, Sprint, the free-flying robotic camera. As pilot of Discovery, Lindsey returned to space alongside Senator John Glenn in 1998 on STS-95. Lindsey's first mission as commander was STS-104, the 10th International Space Station Assembly Mission. After launching on July 12, 2001, the crew of Atlantis rendezvoused with the ISS and conducted joint operations with the Expedition 2 crew in order to install the Quest joint airlock. In addition to installing and activating the joint airlock, the crew also performed the first spacewalk using Quest. Lindsey next commanded STS-121, Discovery. Then on STS-133 in 2011, Lindsey commanded the 39th and final flight of Discovery. During his time with NASA, Lindsey served as deputy for space shuttle operations and co-chair of the Space Shuttle Cockpit Council, as well as the chief of International Space Station Operations for the Astronaut Office. Later, he became chief of the Astronaut Office. In July 2011, Lindsey retired from NASA and joined Sierra Nevada Corporation to lead the Dream Chaser spacecraft flight operations. He is currently the Dream Chaser Senior Director and Co-Program Manager, responsible for managing Dream Chaser space systems development, testing, and production. Ladies and gentlemen, astronaut Steve Lindsey. To present Steve Lindsey for induction into the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame, please welcome Hall of Fame astronaut Michael Coates.
Thank you, John. It's a pleasure and a privilege to be here today to introduce Steve Lindsey into the Astronaut Hall of Fame. Senator John Glenn very much wanted to be here to introduce Steve, but unfortunately he's tied up training for his Orion mission. Just think, someday Steve will proudly tell his grandchildren that he flew with the first American to go into orbit. And they will look at him and think their grandfather must be really, really old. Speaking of grandchildren, if I might, and if Jessica doesn't mind, the countdown has begun to Diane and Steve's first grandchild. Jessica's child is due in September, right? Yeah. And as I told Diane and Steve, if they need any advice on grandchildren, we're all here to help. So. Now, you might think that flying with the true American hero, Senator Glenn, which is really pretty special, might go to Steve's head just a little bit. But I can assure you that Diane and Jessica and Jason and Jill keep Steve well grounded. Diane, in fact, seemed to enjoy pointing out to me that while Steve has had an amazing career and is a devoted family man, he isn't quite perfect. She admitted that, like my wife, Steve is somewhat directionally challenged. Diane said she and the kids have to do the navigating when they travel. Now, having an astronaut, especially the chief of the astronaut office, be directionally challenged is somewhat unusual. So I tried to tease Steve about it. With a bit of a crooked smile, he agreed that he's always had a hard time with that north, south, east, west thing. Then he quickly added that he had no problem with that up and down thing, which is pretty important in our business here. But it may be no small miracle that all Steve's missions managed to land right here in Florida. But I'd like to be serious for a minute and publicly thank Steve for an extraordinary job, certainly as an exceptional crewman on 5 shuttle missions, including 3 as mission commander, but also as chief of the astronaut office. All astronauts are in the public eye, with numerous opportunities to make headlines, good and bad, particularly in the age of modern social media. But as Kent and Dan and Hoot would probably agree, the chief of the astronaut office is under special scrutiny. Faced with difficult and unprecedented circumstances, Steve showed incredible wisdom and dignity and caring in the way he handled some very serious and very public situations, while at the same time continuing to show his strong and decisive leadership to the rest of the astronaut office. His every communication was dissected by fascinated media and public and even Congress. Steve represented all of us extremely well during some trying times. He was exactly the right person in the right position at the right time. And I'd like to thank Steve for making my job and the NASA administrator's jobs, Mike Griffin and Charlie Bolden, I think both are here today, much, much easier. Thanks, Steve. Because I was a pilot on the first flight of Discovery way back in 1984, it meant a lot to me who commanded the last mission of Discovery, which was originally scheduled to be the last shuttle mission. Now, while rumor has it that former JSC directors have occasionally influenced crew assignments, I only made one change to the crews that Steve brought to me for approval. He refused to name himself to the last Discovery mission, so I made that decision. I neglected to ask Diane first, so I hope it was okay. But thank you. Uh-oh. I want to thank Steve for taking that mission. I must admit I was somewhat relieved when you did land where we were expecting you here in Florida. I'd like to summarize this and say that Steve represents the best that this nation can produce and is truly an outstanding role model for all of our young people. He made me and all of us at JSC very, very proud. Congratulations to Steve and Ray and John and Kent. With all due respect to my colleagues down here in front of me, the Astronaut Hall of Fame is being significantly upgraded today. So thanks to all of you for a job well done. And now, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce Colonel Steve Lindsey.
Wow. Well, thank you very much. Like John, I'm very, very humbled to be here today. When I got with this group yesterday, and we were at an event yesterday, and we were doing the groundbreaking for the new facility here, I was standing with all these guys and thinking, and ladies, and thinking, I don't belong here. Because I look out in the audience of the astronauts that are here, and I see so many of you that mentored me. Several out you out there taught me how to fly the shuttle. You taught me how to command a crew. You taught me so much, and just being with you is a humbling experience for me. So thanks to all of you for mentoring me, for being there for me, to teach me the ropes, to keep me out of trouble, and to believing in me enough to for like Bob Cabana to give me a flight assignment for the first time. So thank you very much. Who I really want to recognize though today is my own family, because that's, I wouldn't be here with if it weren't for all of them. You know, the interesting thing about that some of you may not know about being an astronaut is when you go up and fly a shuttle mission or any kind of a space mission, the folks that have it the toughest are the families, because it's a stressful situation for them. It's quite frankly a dangerous business we're in, and it's really tough for them. But my family stood with me, my beautiful wife Diane, who I've been married for 31 years to, and all of my children and their spouses are all here today to see this. And I just want to say thanks to you. Couldn't have done it without you. You know, we arrived, I think, Thursday night, and all our kids were together Friday. And this was the first time our family's ever been here to Kennedy Space Center in this area that it wasn't under stress. And I can tell you it's a completely different experience when either I'm not in quarantine talking to them across a ditch or they're experiencing a stressful situation. So it's just been absolutely wonderful to be here. So thank you to my family in particular for allowing me to go pursue my passion and my dream and do this. And so I think that's all I need to say. I just thank you so much for the honor to be here, to be among this group here that I still don't feel like I deserve to be in. And thank you for all the opportunities that I've been given.
Congratulations, Steve. Welcome to the Astronaut Hall of Fame. Our third inductee is Kent Rominger.
Liftoff of the Space Shuttle Columbia, catapulting scientific knowledge through microgravity research.
A lot of us are missing our families. I've got a 2.5-year-old daughter, and I'm real excited about getting to see her and hold her again.
U.S. Navy Captain Kent Rominger was selected by NASA to become an astronaut in 1992. A veteran of 5 space flights, he has logged more than 1,600 hours in space. Rominger first launched as pilot of STS-73 Columbia in 1995, the second U.S. microgravity laboratory mission. Rominger returned to space aboard Columbia, once more as pilot of STS-80 in 1996. Rominger's third mission as pilot, STS-85 Discovery, launched in 1997. For his first mission as commander, Rominger's 10-day mission was aboard STS-96 Discovery. The crew delivered 4 tons of logistics and supplies to the International Space Station in preparation for arrival of the first crew to live on the station. During his final mission, STS-100 Endeavour, which launched in 2001, Rominger commanded a diverse international crew representing the United States, Russia, Canada, and Italy. Together, they installed the Canadian-built robotic arm and Raffaello logistics module to the ISS. Endeavour was docked 8 days on the most complex robotics flight in the history of the space shuttle program. During his time at NASA, Rominger served in the Astronaut Office Operations Development Branch as Deputy Director of Flight Crew Operations and as Chief of the Astronaut Office from 2002 to 2006. He retired from NASA in 2006 to accept a position with ATK Launch Systems. Ladies and gentlemen, astronaut Kent Rominger. To present Kent Rominger for induction into the U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame, please welcome back to the stage Hall of Fame astronaut and Kennedy Space Center Director, Bob Cabana.
Well, this was a great pleasure when Kent called me and asked me if I'd do this. I've known Kent since he was selected to be an astronaut in 1992, but I really got to know him well when I was chief of the astronaut office. I know of no finer pilot in the astronaut corps. He has a calm, quiet demeanor, but he also has a real need for speed. Now, there was a time one morning when he came to work, and he was trying to avoid me, and I noticed he was limping, and it was prior to one of his flights, when he should really be careful. And he made sure to let me know. He'd been out water skiing is what it was. And he made sure to let me know that water skiing was not on the list of prohibited activities for astronauts assigned to a flight. If you've ever seen Brent Jett and Kent Rominger go at it on a slalom course on water skis, you would definitely agree that it should be prohibited. On snow skis, he claims to have gotten to 78 miles an hour trying to beat a friend who went 80, but I can't verify that. He's also known to be seen out defying gravity on his dirt bike or driving his Subaru WRX with the enhanced performance chip. Utah does have a higher speed limit than the other states, doesn't it? You can't. And then he's also worked his way behind the wheel of a Formula One car. Now, I don't know how this worked out after flights. You know, Kent drives Formula One cars, and I just get more work, but he managed to do it. And then, of course, there's the supersonic F-14 that he flew in the Navy. I've heard that there's a Mach limit on the F-14. If you exceed it, the radome will melt, but you'll have to ask Rommel about that. He is one of the most competitive people I know, and he's up for any challenge, and he usually comes out on top. He is the definition of a fighter pilot and astronaut, but he's also one of the nicest guys that I know. On STS-73, he was Ken Bowersox's pilot. And if they didn't set the record, they had to be awfully close to it for the longest time in quarantine in crew quarters at KSC. And Rommel's claim to fame during that time in quarantine was that he became king of the margarita machine and everybody loved him. It's a tradition that the day before flight, the commander and the pilot take a couple of jets and go out and fly. And Ken Bowersox decided, you know, he didn't need to go do that again. And I said, Kent, come on, let's go get a couple of jets, and we'll go out and we'll do some formation aerobatics. And we did, and we bent those jets every which way you possibly could in close formation. And the next day they launched. And that became a tradition for us. Every time Kent went to go fly, he and I would go fly aerobatics together so that he could get off on time on the next flight. When I became the director of flight crew operations, Charlie Precourt moved from being chief of the astronaut office to deputy program manager for the International Space Station program, and I had the opportunity to pick a new chief astronaut. And for me, there was no question. Kent Rominger was the absolute best choice. He's a skilled pilot, technically excellent in every aspect of the space shuttle, knowledgeable of the space station and its operations, and most importantly, He genuinely cared for the people that worked for them and put their needs above his own. I think one of the hardest things that a chief astronaut has to do is assign crews to flights and then ride out to the launch pad with them. Little did I know that when I asked Kent to be chief astronaut, that both he and I would be tested on our very first flight as Director of Flight Cooperations and Chief of the Astronaut Office in our new positions, and that was STS-107. The loss of Columbia and her crew was heartbreaking, but I can think of no one better to have led the astronaut office during that time than Kent Rominger. He was amazing in his care for the families and in helping the agency and the astronaut office return to flight. And Kent, you have my absolute most sincere thanks. I really appreciate what you did. He's an ace pilot, ace test pilot, a veteran of 5 space shuttle missions, a leader of the highest caliber, and a genuinely nice guy. I can think of no one more deserving for this honor. It's my extreme pleasure to introduce Captain Kent Rominger for induction in the Astronaut Hall of Fame, class of 2015.
Thank you. Hey, thank you. I am so honored and touched. I typically don't get emotional. Thank you, Bob, for making me emotional. But I truly am humbled to be up here today. The Mercury 7, the astronauts through Apollo and shuttle were always heroes of mine, a great inspiration to me. I always wanted to be one of those, one of them, one of us. The fact is, I've got to tell you, I've loved being part of the team. Absolutely. The first time I set foot at Johnson Space Center in Houston, I knew it was special. Because not just the technical folks, but the people in the snack shop, the people that had non-technical jobs, they were so excited about being on the NASA team. We were focused. At that time, I was actually a test pilot student, so NASA was focused on flying the space shuttle. But the other thing is, in my tenure at being an active astronaut, we built the International Space Station, arguably the most difficult construction project that the world has accomplished in centuries, and I'm very proud to have been a part of that. But I'd mentioned teamwork. Teamwork, as a Navy pilot, I started understanding teamwork even more so when I got to NASA, and even sometimes in individual things, because as Bob mentioned, I do tend to be competitive every now and then. And on one mission, it was STS-80. We were airborne. We had a couple satellites we deployed and got to retrieve them. So for a pilot, that was great. A couple of rendezvous to retrieve the satellites after deploying them. And there was also a spacewalk scheduled for 2 of our mission specialists to test out some hardware that was going to go to space station. Sadly, the hatch was jammed, and we weren't able to get the hatch open. Houston, the ground control called up and said, Columbia, tomorrow's going to be a really easy day because we've got to spend the whole day digging through everything to figure out how to help you get that hatch open. And so the next day, I had 3 periods of time that were like 2 to 3 hours long. That never happens to you on orbit. So I decided I'm going to cycle around the world. How many people have cycled around the world? So fortunately, I was with a really good crew, and I jump on the stationary bike, we called it ergometer, and it was down on the mid-deck, and I set the timer at 90 minutes, because it takes 90 minutes, right, to go around the Earth? I set it at 90 minutes, and I'm riding and sweating, and I had a towel, because in space, if you shake your head when you're sweating, you're not going to be very popular with your crewmates. So I'm working, and I'm increasing the resistance as time goes on. And when I climbed on the bike, Story Musgrave was on this flight. As a matter of fact, at that time, and I'm sad Story's not here today, at that time, he was the oldest human to fly in space. He was 61. When I climbed on, he said, Rommel, you have to come back to the same continent. I'm like, of course. Great. Where are we? He said, India. So I'm like, okay. And anyway, I'm pedaling, and I was in pretty good shape. And boy, the last 10 minutes, I had the resistance set so high on that ergometer, I wasn't sure if I was going to make it or not. My timer went off. Story heard it go off and said, hey, Rommel. I said, yeah. He said, I heard your timer go off. I said, it did. I'm done. I've cycled around the world. He said, I said, where are we? Fully expecting to hear India. Story says, Libya. I said, Libya? Don't you mean the other country that ends in an IA like India? And he said, no, Rommel, we're over Libya. I was like, oh, God. And you know, and I kind of always had this rule that I never wanted to reduce the resistance on that ergometer once I'd gotten it to a certain level. Kind of like running, right? When you're out running and you're starting to increase the speed when you get home, you don't ever want to slow down. So I didn't. I left the resistance there and thought I was going to die. But about 7-8 minutes later, Story called down and said, hey, Rommel, we're over India. So I unstrapped and shot up to the flight deck and looked. And sure enough, we were over India. And I looked at Story and started to say, that was like 98 minutes. You know, and he was just smiling because he knew all along when I climbed on this bike, being a pilot, 90 minutes, it does take you 90 minutes to go around the world, but the world is rotating under you. So for me to really cycle all the way around the world, Story knew all along, I wasn't going to be able to do it unless he was there to help me. So thankfully, Story helped me make it around the world. And I do. I do Bob, you know, Top Gun kind of coin Need for Speed. I was actually interviewed before they made that movie. And I do. I think I have a defect where I just have this need for acceleration. And so being a young astronaut, I loved it. I loved the wildly exhilarating experiences associated with getting to fly in space. But over time, I really began to value and appreciate being part of the management team. And if my F-14 buddies, one of them's here, ever heard me say that, I'm sure they would fall out of their chair. But it really became important to me. So as a commander of the space shuttle, as a chief of the astronaut office, I really began to value what it meant to give back. So that's actually one of the two reasons that the Astronaut Hall of Fame is so very special to me, is first of all, being able to associate with the folks sitting here today, some very near and dear friends that I've had a wonderful experiences with. But the second one is giving back. And watching the astronaut scholars today just further invigorated me to that really is what it's about. So this group is all about giving back to our community. We're trying to better, we're trying to promote STEM education, to better our space program, our nation, and ideally the entire globe. So it's very, very special. Lastly, the support I've had coming through this, thank you. I've got friends here that I've known since I was 2 years old. Friends and folks I work with in industry are here today. Friends from the Navy, NASA, all over. Thank you all for letting me be a part of your world. And then family. And you know, I'm not going to articulate well how important family is to me and has always been to me. But I just have to say, you know, a big thanks. I've got my sister, nephews, nieces, aunts, uncles, cousins, friends, and these are on both sides of my family and Mary Sue's family. Thank you so much for coming out here today. And then lastly, you know, I've got to be married to the most special, beautiful lady on the planet. She is so understanding and unselfish, Mary Sue. Thank you for encouraging us on this journey of ours. Would never have made it without you. In addition to a great wife, Mary Sue is a phenomenal mother. And I think it's fair to say our grandest accomplishment to date is our 22-year-old daughter. Thank you.
Kent, did you fly over Madagascar? I'm a little bit concerned here. He didn't know whether it was Madagascar or South America. Is it India or Libya or what? And this guy in the middle, he didn't know north, south, east from west. Good thing there wasn't a lot of traffic up there. Congratulations, Ken. Welcome to the U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame. Our final inductee is Rhea Seddon.
have SRB ignition and liftoff. Liftoff of mission 51D.
Now that looks, in fact, that looks excellent. As usual, you've managed to improve on our basic ideas, so it looks really good.
Ray, I'd like to commend you on your dexterity in hitting that pin on the side of the satellite. I could think of a job on a ranch in California that you might be interested in.
Ignition and liftoff of Columbia on the first dedicated medical research flight.
How do all the pieces and parts fit together? The different systems, how do they interact? And we hope to bring home an awful lot of good information on all seven of us, as a matter of fact.
Booster ignition and liftoff of Columbia on a life sciences mission for Earth and space.
Dr. Rhea Seddon was selected by NASA in January of 1978 and became an astronaut in August 1979 as part of the first U.S. astronaut class to include women. A three-flight veteran, she has logged over 722 hours in space. Seddon lifted off aboard STS-51D Discovery on her first mission in 1985 as a mission specialist, where she performed numerous science and medical experiments, including the first ultrasound of a human heart in space. In 1991, on STS-40 Columbia, Seddon once again served as mission specialist on the first Space Lab Life Sciences flight, SLS-1, where the crew studied how cells respond to microgravity and readapt to Earth's gravity upon return. As payload commander on her third flight and final flight, STS-58, which launched in 1993, Seddon was in charge of all science activities aboard Columbia. This Space Lab Life Sciences mission, SLS-2, received NASA management recognition as the most successful and efficient space lab flown to date. During her time at NASA, Seddon worked in a variety of areas. She led the planning of and served as a helicopter physician for operations with the Search and Rescue Forces and NASA for the first four shuttle flights. Helped develop the medical kit and checklist, shuttle food systems, crew medical officer training, and life sciences experiment plans for the shuttle program. Made major contributions to Challenger accident investigations, represented the astronaut office on the NASA Aerospace Advisory Committee and Bioethics Task Force, served as CAPCOM, and more. After leaving NASA in 1997, Dr. Seddon served as the Assistant Chief Medical Officer of the Vanderbilt Medical Group in Nashville for 11 years. There, she led an initiative aimed at improving patient safety, quality of care, and team effectiveness by the use of an aviation-based model of crew resource management. Now, with LifeWings Partners, she teaches this concept to healthcare institutions across the United States. Recently, she has written a memoir entitled Go for Orbit to inspire young women to pursue careers in science and technology. Ladies and gentlemen, astronaut Rhea Seddon. And to present Rhea Seddon for induction into the U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame, please welcome Hall of Fame astronaut Hoot Gibson. What a surprise.
Thank you. Well, this has never happened before. This is the first time that a spouse has had the wonderful opportunity that I have today to present my wife for induction into the Astronaut Hall of Fame. All of my friends, I think they are my friends, in the Astronaut Corps have been telling me, you know, this could be kind of risky. Don't mess this up. As a fighter pilot, it could be very risky to land aboard an aircraft carrier at night. What I'm doing right now could be just as risky. But this is really a thrill for me. And I want to say that we astronauts owe a real debt of gratitude to Dr. Rhea Seddon, because she eagerly embraced life sciences and everything involving life sciences. Now, you mentioned life sciences to the astronauts, and what does that mean to us? That means needles. That means blood draws. That means all kinds of horrible animal torture directed against us humans. Rhea eagerly embraced it. And that's why she was part of the first Space and Life Sciences mission, SLS-2, and then payload commander on SLS-1. Rhea grew up in a small town in Tennessee. It used to be a small town in Tennessee called Murfreesboro, and I think half of Murfreesboro is here tonight. Can you make some noise, Murfreesboro? Yes. She has a great many friends here from Murfreesboro, and we are thrilled to have our dear friends from back home here with us tonight. You know, we've heard an awful lot about chief astronauts tonight. We have four former chief astronauts on the stage. We have seen several other former chief astronauts grace the stage. And I want to say something about that. It was a really exalted position. I was extremely honored to hold that position. And our chief astronauts have been real leaders. But you know what? Not one of us was a pioneer or a trailblazer like Dr. Rhea Seddon was as one of the first six women astronauts. She was in that very first group, the first time we ever selected women. And we've all had an interesting career. We've all had challenges presented to us. I don't know that any of them were more significant than the challenges that got presented to our first group of women astronauts, because there was a tremendous amount of focus on the first six women. And I think there were a lot of people sitting there saying, can the women really hack it? Well, there is no doubt about it. The women have hacked it easily as good, if not better, than any of us ever did, because we weren't under the same microscope that they were. Rhea and I took turns flying. I flew in 1984 as the astronaut hero, and she was the astronaut spouse. 1985, she was the astronaut hero, and I got to be the astronaut spouse. I flew in 86, and it went on that way the whole time we were there. We took turns flying, so one of us would be the hero, and the other one would be the spouse. Now, I got asked all the time, did you and Rhea ever fly together in space? And the joke that I like to tell is, well, no, you know, that really wouldn't have worked. It just wouldn't have worked out. Most of the time when I flew, I was the mission commander. And so how's it going to work? I turn to Rhea and I say, Rhea, it's time to open the sun shields. And she's going to say, you want the sun shields open. You go open them yourself. Don't try and pull this mission commander stuff on me. So it just wouldn't have worked. It wouldn't have worked for us to fly together. Now, okay, that's a joke. That never happened. But here's a true story. This actually did happen. When I was made chief astronaut, I couldn't supervise my wife, because in the government service, you can't be your wife's boss or supervise. So what they did was, on a piece of paper, a worthless piece of paper, they transferred her to report directly to my boss, the director of flight operations. So I remember, you know, several times I'd say, Rhea, you know what you need to do? You need to do this. And she'd say, I don't work for you. And I'd say, yes, you do. You're an astronaut. I'm the chief astronaut. You work for me. And she'd say, no, I don't. I report to the director of flight operations. So why should it be any different in the office than it was at home? As a spouse, I had to get over some things that took a little while to get used to. When Ray and I first married, she kept her maiden name. That's why she's still Rhea Seddon. And the boys, my buddies in the Astronaut Corps, put a name tag on my locker in the astronaut gym that said, Hoot Seddon. I gotta tell you, it really torqued me off. And I knew darn well that if I did what I wanted to do, which was rip that thing off the locker, throw it in the trash, there'd be another one up the very next day. So I knew that I couldn't do that. So I let it sit there for 3 years. And then I ripped it off and threw it in the trash. And fortunately, I didn't get another one. But there were things that I had to get used to. Speaking of when I first married Ray, I want to thank all of you for being here today to celebrate our 34th wedding anniversary, which is today. So this is the real reason that all of us are here today. I also had one more opportunity to learn to smile and be a good spouse. Along with John Blaha's crew, STS-58, we attended the Fiesta Bowl, I think it was 1993, and her crew was the featured crew, and I was there, at the time I was the chief astronaut, but I was an astronaut spouse attending the Fiesta Bowl. You can see it coming. They had a name tag for me, and it said, Mr. Seddon. So, over the years, I have learned to handle all of this. Well, Ray and I have been extremely fortunate. We have been extremely lucky. I have been extremely lucky to have her. We enjoyed flying 8 missions between the two of us over that 18, 19 years that we spent at NASA. And we got to work with wonderful folks like these. So what an experience it has been for us. What a journey it has been for us. Maybe I can't say that. Ray, life with you has been beyond my wildest dreams. On behalf of the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation, welcome to the Astronaut Hall of Fame.
To adjust the microphone. Don't you like the picture up there that makes me look as tall as Kent Rominger? Not. Well, you know, there are moments in everyone's life when he or she looks around and says, what the heck am I doing here? For those of us who have flown in space, that moment often comes when we first look out the window at the Earth from orbit. But I'm having one of those moments right now, having watched my friends and my husband be inducted into this auspicious group. I never expected to be standing here. A doctor who mostly wanted to do life sciences research? Come on. But my goals when I came to NASA were simple, and they never wavered. On the shuttle, when the astronaut explorers were looking at the heavens, at the stars, and others were looking at our magnificent Earth, I wanted to look at the explorers that were doing those jobs. When I became part of the Astronaut Corps in 1978, I had wonderful mentors like those of you who are here today, and I so much appreciate that. I came from a medical background and didn't really know much about computers or spaceflight or anything like that, so I was very lucky that there were people that helped me along the way. being part of the first group of women astronauts, there was a particular pressure on us to do well. I think each of us knew, as I did, that if I did something wrong or made a big mistake, people wouldn't say, Rhea Seddon made a mistake. They would say, women can't do this job. So there was extra pressure on us back then. I was fortunate that Dr. Joe Kerwin, who flew on the first Skylab mission and was the first physician in space, became a mentor to me. We flew all across the country talking to very eminent scientists who hoped to put experiments on the space shuttle. And so that really got me off to a pretty good start. I had many assignments at NASA, things like verifying the space shuttle software and using the robot arm. But I also got to work on things that I knew something about, like what should the contents of the space shuttle medical kit be, and even some things like defining the training for the non-physician astronauts who would serve as crew medical officers. I mean, can you imagine Hoot and some of these guys learning how to be doctors? That was a lot of fun. On my first flight in 1985, you saw some of the film, and by the way, did you notice that over time the quality of the film improved? The cameras got a little bit better. It was kind of a vanilla flight. Of course, any flight's a good flight, especially your first one. But we were to launch a couple of satellites and to do a few small experiments, and it was a short flight, 5 days. But things got interesting when one of those satellites didn't work. We deployed it into space and it didn't turn itself on. And you saw some of on the video, my job, Mission Control, came up with a plan to help us figure out how to turn on that satellite. My job, as you saw, it was to design that fly swatter, to build it by their design. I got to do the first surgery in space, sewing that thing together. It was interesting, the Capcom and Mission Control called up and said, you're a really good seamstress. Sally Ride happened to be in Mission Control at the time, and she said, no, she's a really good surgeon. So I appreciated that. It became even more interesting when two members of the crew had to go out and do a spacewalk to attach those devices to the end of the robot arm. And that was Dave Griggs and, of course, Jeff Hoffman, who's sitting down here. And Jeff, can you believe that was 30 years ago last month? We haven't aged a bit, have we? Then there were two other members of the crew who had the very important task of going and rendezvousing with that shuttle. Now remember, none of us had been trained to do any of this. The rendezvous was particularly sporting because we had to go over and fly up really close to a multi-ton satellite that was slowly drifting in space. And of course, our commander, Bo Bobko, who is also here today. Thank you for coming, Bo. Did a masterful job getting us over close enough for me to flip that switch with the fly swatters on the end of the arm to try and turn it on. Well, unfortunately, the satellite did not even activate, and another crew had to go up later and rewire the internal electronics on it to get it on its way. The ground thought we would be really disappointed that the satellite didn't turn itself on, but believe it or not, we were elated. We had done things that had never been planned. We had great support from Mission Control, who helped us through it, told us how to do it, and we were just happy that we didn't kill ourselves. I guess there was one other really important mission that I had to accomplish on that flight. We flew the first politician in space, Senator Jake Garn from Utah, and Jake volunteered to do some studies of space motion sickness that affects a lot of astronauts. And the press came to call him Barfing Jake Garn. He did his job really well. But it was my duty to make sure that he made it back alive. As was mentioned, my other two flights were the ones that I really hoped for when I came to fly for NASA. That was Space Lab Life Sciences 1 and 2. And as was also mentioned, as Hoot mentioned, not a whole lot of people volunteered to do those icky flights where you got poked and prodded. But I was always fascinated to help understand the magnificent adaptability of the human body. So we looked at many body systems while we were in in space, and we got to see how they all interacted together for the first time. Importantly, half of the 8 subjects on those 2 flights were women. And when we got the data back, we could say for sure that women adapted to weightlessness the same way that men do. That was a very important thing to prove. Well, along this journey, I met and married Hoot and became a second mother to his beautiful daughter, Julie, who is here with 2 of my grandsons all the way from Madagascar. And she really did come from Madagascar. And it wasn't South America, was it, Julie? No? Okay. Good, I'm glad I got that straight. Hoot and I also produced the world's first astro-tot, and that's a child born to 2 astronauts, that's Paul, and then 2 others, Dan and Emily, who are also here with me today. But I want you to imagine back into the dark ages of 1982, when Hoot and I had to go and tell our big boss, the director of the Johnson Space Center, Dr. Chris Kraft, about my pregnancy. And you know, there had been a lot of hoopla the year before when we married each other. Everybody, you know, talked about that, wow, astronauts marrying each other. And so we walked into Dr. Kraft's office and sat down, and Hoot said very seriously, "Dr. Kraft, we have something to tell you." And he looked rather alarmed, and he said, "You're getting divorced." And we said, "No, there's a better news than that." Well, everything went really well with those pregnancies, and we proved once and for all that astronauts can have babies, too. That was a first. So for those of you who know Hoot, you know, you understand his wicked sense of humor and how interesting it has been to, he's got a halo above his head over here, to be married to him. Well, Hoot loves airplanes, and he delighted in teaching me how to fly the NASA jets. Although on occasion he did refer to me as talking ballast, I think, something like that. Ooh. And he even showed me how quiet those jets can get when you're at 35,000 feet and both your engines quit. Very quiet. Well, we survived that episode, and I had the great honor to become an astronaut spouse on Hoot's 5 flights. And I developed a great admiration for the women and then the men who held that title. In all the craziness of a crew's getting ready for flight, it's the spouses that have to pick up the slack. And they have to steel themselves from the fear that they have in their own hearts. So bless them all for the often unrecognized contributions that they made to human spaceflight. And of course, Hoot had to play spouse too. During my first flight, he had to take care of young Paul, who was not yet 3 years old. And afterwards, friends said, "Oh, they were so cute walking down the beach together, looking at the pretty girls." And then some of Hoot's friends said, "Yeah, he was going around saying that Paul made really good trolling bait." Well, that's Hoot, yeah. Well, this occasion is kind of like a pre-launch reception, only better. As crews for our flights, we're always in quarantine and never get to say hello to our guests, so I'm looking forward on this occasion to saying hi to all of my friends who are here and introducing them to one another, and I look forward to greeting you all, especially my own cheering section from Murfreesboro. Well, today is another kind of launch for me. My new book, Go for Orbit, about my NASA days, was just published, rolled off the presses last week. And I'll have some copies available for signing at a private reception this evening, but also there are some at the bookstore, and I'll be there tomorrow afternoon at 3 for those of you who are still here that would like a signed copy. It's been in work since I was at NASA. That's over 20 years, so it's quite nice to have it out the door. I want to give my heartfelt thanks to the Astronaut Hall of Fame for the wonderful honor that they're bestowing on me today. I look forward to supporting the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation that allows young people to live their dreams as I did. Thank you all for sharing this very special occasion.
Congratulations, Ray, and welcome to the U.S. Astronaut Hall of Fame. Question is, though, did you fly over Madagascar? You did, yeah. She probably knew where she was all the time.
Maybe it was South America.
South America. The 2015 inductees were selected by a committee of current Hall of Fame astronauts, former NASA officials, historians, and journalists. The process is administered by the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation. To be eligible, an astronaut must have made his or her first flight at least 17 years before the induction year and must be retired at least 5 years from the NASA Astronaut Corps. Candidates must be a U.S. citizen, NASA-trained, commander, pilot, or mission specialist, and must have orbited the Earth at least once and made significant contributions to the study of space. Ladies and gentlemen, I am proud to present to you the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame, Class of 2015, John Grunsfeld, Steve Lindsey, Kent Rominger, and Rhea Seddon. And now, all the members of the United States Astronaut Hall of Fame, please join us for a photo. Thank you, sir. If you would please walk the red carpet, all the inductees, current inductees and astronauts, walk the red carpet out and meet up with your families. Yes.
We're supposed to go that way?
Yes. It has been my pleasure to be with you today on behalf of the Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex and the Astronaut Scholarship Foundation. Thank you for joining us for the historic ceremony. Please remain standing as the Hall of Fame astronauts make their grand exit down the red carpet if they can get out. Thank you. And next year we will have a full list of every astronaut who passed Madagascar.